Good afternoon. When I offered to deliver this talk, the initial reaction was one of surprise. Not their fault. Actually, my personality is such that even my mother has never felt confident in me. Anyway, my defense was that I might have some useful things to say about the Indian Army. Still not convinced. It was then that I played my ace. I said, I come free. I will not cost anything. Since money never fails to talk, this argument won the day for me. So I must admit at the very outset that I stand here. Thank you. So I must admit at the very outset that I stand here not on merit, but as a compromise, cost-saving initiative. And what I am going to do over next 20 minutes is to tell you the story of Lance Naik, Mohan, Nath, Goswami. To be specific, it is the story of those 11 eventful days when this remarkable soldier eliminated 10 militants. To put that achievement in context, a vast majority of the army soldiers go through their entire professional life without a single kill, and in most cases, without even experiencing live firing. Mohan Nath comes from Lal Kuan village near Nainital. A regular boy next door, you wouldn't throw a second glance if you passed him on the road. He has the crew cut hair just like 90% of the Indian Army soldiers have. He has the slightly hardy look of a Highlander, but his face gives absolutely no indication of what lies inside. However, if I told you that he comes from one of the only 9 special forces battalions of the Indian Army, you could begin to get some idea about him. As the name suggests, the special forces or the SF battalions are truly special. We are talking about the best 7,000 soldiers in an army of 1.3 million people. At the beginning of their career, they go through a 3-month probation. This probation puts them through a balanced diet of physical and mental torture, sleep deprivation, and extreme exhaustion over a period of 90 long days. It is widely acknowledged as one of the toughest probations in the world. It inspires so much of fear in the army circles that only the fittest and the most motivated opt to even try. You know what is the success rate in the special forces probation? 10%. Out of the creamiest minority who aspire to be an SF soldier, 90% drop out within first 3 months. Many of them much earlier, because the only pleasant thing about the SF probation is that you can opt to drop out on any day. Our protagonist, Mohan Nath, is the hero of this story. He is the product of this program, but there is more. His company commander, Major Anurag Kumar, a supremely fit officer himself, says this about him. Mohan Nath is far above the standard of even our battalion. Trust me, when it comes to the business of soldiering, there cannot be a bigger compliment than this. Mohan comes from a battalion based out of the hill town of Udhampur. This battalion sends out heli-borne teams of para commandos into the Kashmir Valley whenever things get too tricky for the normal soldiers. Over those 11 days in August-September 2015, Mohan Nath battled the militants in 3 separate operations. Since these operations have similarities, I am going to skip the first one and talk about the other 2. About the first operation, it is sufficient to say that it took place in the politically sensitive Handwara town. It happened on the night between 21st and 22nd August 2015 and ended with Mohan Nath's team eliminating 3 militants. Coming to the second operation called Operation Lidar Panzal. Now, August is a busy month for the Indian Army in Kashmir. The snow would soon descend on the formidable mountains, making infiltration impossible from September to April next year. Therefore, the Pakistani army handlers tried to send in as many militants as possible by August end. So Mohan Nath was not surprised when a fresh intelligence input came in on 26th August. 5 militants had infiltrated across the line of control, or LOC, in the Udi sector. They had trekked over the Shamsabadi mountain range and were now moving towards the lowlands. Now let me explain as to how army organizes its defense in JNK. On the line of control, army has a 3-tier defense posture. The first tier battalions are deployed right on the LOC in what is called the eyeball to eyeball contact. The second tier battalions are deployed on mountains slightly to the back. And the third tier consists of the Rashtriya Rifles battalions, which are the specialist counterinsurgency units. These were raised in the 1990s when the militancy in the valley was at its peak. The idea is that the infiltrators will get trapped in one of these 3 tiers. However, the area is so large and so difficult that they are often able to dodge all 3 tiers, in many cases, with active support of the local population. The current squad of militants had gone through the first 2 tiers but had run into a patrol of Rashtriya Rifles. One of the militants had been killed while the other 4 managed to escape. The Rashtriya Rifles team leader promptly called for a drone to track the militants. A drone was scrambled from a nearby airbase and it was presently hovering over the barren Shamsabadi range with its camera and thermal imagers switched on. The mountain was littered with enormous boulders and a network of caves. Now, to escape detection, the militants move by the night and lie low by the day. So at 5:45 a.m., the 4 militants entered a cave covered by huge rocks where they would stay until the sun went down. Unknown to the militants, at 7 a.m., an army helicopter took off from Udhampur with 12 paracommandos. Major Anurag Kumar and our friend Mohan Nath Goswami were on the helicopter. At 9:30 a.m., the squad was dropped at a location about 4 kilometers away from the location of the militants. The most important aspect of this operation was that it was taking place at 13,000 feet. I can tell you that at that altitude, even the fittest people get fatigued due to lack of oxygen. Although I have been in a combat situation only once in my career, I have spent a full year on a post at 18,000 feet. Out of my 22 years in the army, that year was the most difficult. At that altitude, both the body and the mind tend to go a little bit crazy. Anyway, guided by the drone, the commandos started moving towards the location of the militants. Mohan Nath was leading in the scout position. Whenever a squad moves in a tactical formation, the leading man called the scout is most exposed to danger. It is like cricket silly point, you know? Mohan Nath had a special liking for the scout position. Major Anurag had told him on a couple of occasions, "You are now senior enough. Why don't you let the younger colleagues come up the order?" His response, "Sir, the day I find a teammate who can be a better scout than me, I would let him come up." For the moment, he was leading. By noon, the commandos were close to the location of the militant hideout. Major Anurag divided the team into 2 squads. One squad went on a faint trail that they could see on the hillside, while the other squad went higher up on the ridge to take up a commanding position. It took an hour for both the squads to reach their designated locations. The squad higher up on the ridge reported that they could see the gray robe of a militant behind a huge 30-foot boulder. Meanwhile, as the leading man in the other squad, Mohan Nath had reached quite close to the cave. By now, the militants had got a wind that they were being surrounded. as usually happens, they panicked and opened fire. And as always, Mohan Nath was deadly accurate with his Israeli TAR-21 rifle and was able to injure one of the militants. The commandos immediately cordoned off the area surrounding the cave. The militants had been cornered. However, whether it is a cave or a house, storming it is never a good idea. It always leads to casualties to own men. The good thing was that the commandos had adequate rations and ammunition and could therefore afford to play the waiting game. As the sun went down, just to send a clear message to the militants that there was no way out, Major Anurag ordered a soldier to fire 2 grenades at the cave. Faced with the blast, 2 of the 4 militants panicked. They came out of the cave and tried to make a run for the safety. The moment they emerged into the open area, 2 shots were heard. Lance Naik Mohan Nath had fired 2 rounds from his rifle, immediately cutting down both the militants. After a frantic spell of firing, a deathly quiet descended on the ridge that night. It was a cold and long night. At noon next day, Mohan Nath spotted the leg of one of the militants behind a huge rock and fired. Soon after, the injured militant hobbled out, firing from his weapon. He was immediately cut down by the deadly fire from the para commandos. The 4th militant was convinced to surrender. 4 militants down with no injury to own men, Operation Lidder Panzal was an unqualified success. Let's get away from Mohan Nath for a moment and move across the continents to New York. The date is 15th January 2009. An Airbus A320 takes off from LaGuardia Airport in New York at 3:25 p.m. It is being piloted by Captain Chesley Sullenberger, or Sully, as he is known by his colleagues. Not for the first time in his career, Sully's plane is hit by the birds. But this bird hit is different from the previous ones. For one, the birds are the Canadian geese. Each of them weighs 3 to 7 kgs and has a wingspan of 6 feet. Moreover, they like to travel in flocks. So Sully's plane is not hit by a bird, but by a flock of rather large geese. The aircraft shudders a little. There's a burning smell coming from both the engines, indicating that at least 2 birds had found their way into the engines. And then suddenly, everything goes eerily quiet. Sully realizes that both the engines of his aircraft had failed. He immediately tells Pat Harton, a young air traffic controller, that things were not looking good and that he would require an emergency landing. Now, New York is served by a network of airports. 3 immediate options for Sully are to either return to LaGuardia Airport or to try and land his aircraft at Neva or Teterboro airports. Pat Harton processes all 3 options and tells the ATC at all 3 airports to keep the nearest runway ready for the crippled plane. Meanwhile, Sully is piloting an aircraft which has essentially become a glider. It is falling off the skies at an alarming rate. While Pat Harton is feeding him information about the runways on the 3 airports, Sully has stopped listening to him. Instead, he announces on the system, "This is Captain speaking. Brace for impact." Few moments later, the aircraft lands and comes to a halt. Sully has done the unimaginable by landing his plane on the Hudson River in what would come to be known in the aviation circles as the miracle on the Hudson. You know, out of 155 crew and passengers, how many people died or had serious injuries? 0. None. But that itself is not the most amazing thing. The most remarkable part, in fact, is the timelines of the incident. The birds hit the plane 3:27 p.m. The plane makes contact with the freezing water of Hudson River, 3:30 p.m. Total time taken, 3 minutes, 32 seconds. Sully took 3 minutes and 32 seconds to decide that, number one, my plane is going down. Number two, I would not be able to make it back to LaGuardia. Number three, I would not be able to make it to Newark or Teterboro either. Number four, the roads in the area are not wide enough to land my plane. And number five, my best chance is to land my plane in the Hudson River for what would become the only successful water landing in the aviation history. Aren't we fortunate that we get to make our decisions sitting in the air-conditioned offices with sufficient time to process all the information? And yet, back to Mohan Nath. Mohan Nath's third operation came on 2nd September. There were intelligence reports about the presence of four militants in Sutsliar jungles of Kupwara. Six squads with a total of 36 men were deployed on either side of a forest stream. The commandos had been in place for the entire day on 2nd September. At 8:30 p.m., they noticed the four militants as they arrived in the area. As soon as the militants were challenged by the commandos, there was an instantaneous response. The forest came alive with the clatter of the assault rifle firing. But then suddenly, all the guns fell silent. No one moved. The slightest movement would give away own location. Shortly after midnight, one of the militants fired a grenade from his underbarrel grenade launcher. The grenade hit the tree branches and exploded. The splinters rained down on two para commandos who had taken shelter under the tree. The wounded commandos were now pinned down and were sitting ducks. Lance Naik Mohan Nath and his buddy Havaldar Mahinder Singh sprang from their locations and ran towards the injured colleagues while firing from their weapons. The militants opened a burst of fire. It killed Havaldar Mahinder Singh instantly. Meanwhile, Mohan Nath was firing furiously from his weapon even as he was hit by two bullets. He didn't know at the time, but two of the four militants had immediately perished. The remaining two militants were killed in the firefight that ensued, and the operation was over by the morning of 3rd September. Why do we talk about Mohan Nath? Is there anything that he can teach us? Of course, he is the epitome of the R1 value of teamwork. When it comes to leading his team as the scout, Mohan Nath is there. When it comes to saving his injured colleagues in the heat of battle, he doesn't flinch. For Mohan Nath, teamwork is not a value. It's a way of life. However, I have not told you the story of only a brilliant individual. I have also told you the story of a brilliant team which allowed this individual to flourish. Moreover, it turns out that teamwork has an important ally here, which is the power of decisive action. The situations which our friend encounters day in and day out are the ones in which decisive action is a matter not of choice, but of life and death. There is no time for or perhaps, or I think, or let's have another meeting, or my personal favorite, looping you in. When I loop in someone, I am telling him, I am going to take an important decision. If it goes well, don't bother. I am there to take the credit. But if anything goes wrong, I am nominating you as my scapegoat. Such responses are not decisions. These are deceptions. And we are managers, not deceivers. We come to office each day to take tough and fair decisions, and most important, to take responsibility for those decisions. we would do well to remember the advice of former US President Roosevelt that in any moment of decision, the best thing that we can do is to do the right thing. The next best thing is the wrong thing. And the worst thing that we can do is to do nothing. There is a postscript to the story of Lance Naik, Mohan Nath, Goswami. On 26th January 2016, a grateful nation bestowed upon him Ashok Chakra, the highest gallantry award of the country. It was received by his wife, Bhavna Goswami, even as Mohan Nath watched from above. They say that a soldier never dies. He just fades away. The third operation that I just narrated was also Mohan Nath's last. On that night, after being shot twice, he lost more blood than even his hardened body could bear, and he faded away. Thank you.